Hey, good morning, everybody. It's my real pleasure to introduce our final speaker, Lieutenant General Retired Mr. Graeme. We'll discuss the future operating environment and the role of special operations forces in the future, and how we can prepare our forces to meet the evolving threats we face and transform the operating environment. Sir Graeme Lamb retired from the British Army after 38 years of long and distinguished service and military career, both regular UK Army and UK Special Forces. He served as the director of the UKSF from 2001 to 2003, Deputy Commanding General of North National Force Iraq from 2006 to 2007. And as the commander of the UK Field Army from 2007 to 2009. Her Majesty's government has formally recognized him on 7 occasions for his service. As Deputy Commanding General, MNFI, Sir Graeme played a pivotal role in the Sunni awakening. For his exceptional service in Iraq, he was awarded the Legion of Merit by the United States. In 2009, he stepped down as commander of the Field Army to return to Afghanistan at the direct request of General David Petraeus and General Stanley Crystal of the U.S. to serve as a special advisor and head of program designed to repeat the successes he'd overseen in Iraq. Since his retirement, Sir Graeme has served as a special advisor to the G3 Good Governance Group, chair of Strategy Council at the C5 Capital Limited, and worked with the Walking with Wounded chair. Please join me in welcoming Sir Graeme, who is really a legend in the special operations community.
What do they say? Lies, damn lies, and introductions. I suppose I should thank SOCOM for hauling my old bones across the Atlantic to come and talk to you. But actually, the last 2 days have been fascinating. Awesome insights. Expert speakers, people who actually knew what they were talking about. It's all downhill from here. There's a grain of truth in this one. If you've lost an empire, you've got to keep a sense of humor, if nothing else, in your community. Don't lose your sense of humor when it's all going south. And I'm just about to tell you, and just load on to what you heard from the last panel, in many ways, why it is. The Assistant Secretary yesterday absolutely nailed it when she turned around and said, and talked about a failure of your imagination. Your proven competencies, your proven character, your proven capabilities, established culture, is known to all in this room and amongst all. That's what's not being challenged. The question is whether you can not just follow the words. I listen to what people say in this world, I judge them by what they do. And so the term thinking the unthinkable just rolls off the tongue nice and easy. The truth is, can you do it? Because I sense in truth, if you just think about it, you probably won't. If you just try, you probably won't. If you recognize the clear and present danger that is there, and you face the responsibility you have to your nation, its people, its prosperity, and their way of life, that you really do need to get to grips with thinking the unthinkable. And that's in your space, not ours. December Christmas. I fly back here tonight, go back to UK, and land in Heathrow. I'm going to meet up with Stan and Annie and go and drink some Bud Light Lime. No one drinks Bud Light Lime on Christmas. The damn pool. But his book, Team of Teams, which I had to buy, it's not a bad read. But this is what he said of your community in 2003. The task force hadn't chosen to change. We were driven by necessity, although lavishly resourced and exquisitely trained. We found ourselves losing to an enemy that by traditional calculus we should have dominated. Over time we came to realize that more than our foe, we, y'all, were struggling to cope with an environment that was fundamentally different from anything we had planned or trained for. The speed and interdependence of events had produced new dynamics that threatened to overwhelm the time-honored processes and culture we had built. But welcome back to an inflection point. Because you're right there, right now, and Stan McChrystal's an old retired bloke like me. The challenge is significant, and it applies not only to the top-end JSON. It applies to everyone in this room. It's not about in fact looking for new, smarter bits of kit. It's about you, collectively, individually, and for your own nation states, thinking the unthinkable. It's about playing the hand that you're given, not the hand you want. Life is just damn unfair, and we, every man and woman here, just knows that for being an absolute truth. Future fact one. This is an absolute truth. Philip Gottfried von Clausewitz, a very dull German Prussian general, wrote 8 almost unintelligible books on war. He spent his entire life in battle. So he had a position and a perspective which you should not in any way discount. He talked about the unholy trinity between Parliament, the people, and the armed forces. Those three groups, and you fit underneath all three of those for your authorities and your ability to get on and do shit, are at their best only when the going is good. If there is insufficient and austerity is biting into your Ministry of Defense, trust me, you go down to the low drawer. If you make a tactical error, 1, 2, maybe 3 strikes, the nation loses its trust. And if personal or party politics get in the way of what would be difficult policy, a change that is necessary in order for you to do things, the truth of the matter is, you're not loved. Just get over it. But understanding that position from where you are now is really important, because I get lots of people saying, oh, it's fantastic, you know, thank you for your service, all this sort of stuff. I say, who gives a rat's ass? I'm really interested in doing duty, service, sacrifice. It's not about self. It's not for self and anyone in this room. It's about doing the right thing. It's about making a damn difference when the world is simply unraveling. Future fact 2. Alfred Lord Tennyson, the poem Ulysses captures it very nicely. We are not now that strength which in old days moved earth and heaven. That which we are, we are. One equal temper of heroic hearts, made weak by time and fate, yet strong of will to strive, to seek, to find, and not to yield. The key word, made weak by time and fate, because I sense that is the harsh reality of where you all are. Who's adapting and who is the best adjusting? You've heard a number of speakers over the last 2 or 3 days. Your own world experience has told you a great deal. My sense is the opposition are adapting, morphing, changing at a wicked pace. And on a really good day, you're probably just adjusting. Seventy-five years ago, Colonel David Sterling found himself having to climb a fence on a pair of crutches to break his way in to the military command in Cairo with nothing other than a pocketful of imagination. He told the High Command that it was his view that he could destroy more German aircraft in North Africa than the Royal Air Force and never leave the ground. Just imagination. The SOE, OSS, didn't set Europe alight. They set up a number of fires. Perception did the rest. Fear. Imagination took control. Winston Churchill once said of his chiefs of staff, "What do you get? I get the sum of their fears." And they were seasoned warriors from the Great War, now sitting on the center. This is a harsh slide. You have enjoyed, by dint of time and fate, the first capability dominance. You own the night. Well, I just think you might be losing the day. It's going dark. NSA, GCHQ can't see the spaces they could look into 3 years ago. The opposition, the people that you are contesting, are morphing at a rate, and they're not stupid. Oh yeah, they get killed a lot, but they're not stupid. And their approach is quite simply capability avoidance. And they're doing it really well. And the enemy are not just simply Daesh or some other terrorist organization that you might find out there and look around. And the danger is you'll find yourself in a place which is the last bullet. Don't confuse activity with progress. Looking good will not win the day. Doing more of the same, peddling harder, polishing the turd, will just turn you to that last bullet, which is broadly irrelevant as far as the forces that are operating against you. We enjoy a world where we killed conventional forces, overwhelmingly using conventional and unconventional means. We have, for these last few decades, and you know it only too well, struggled to kill 8 symmetric threats symmetrically, the whole of government. been much progress in the intelligence services, the arrangements between agencies, the Bureau, MI5-6, all the rest of your own in your own countries. But the very best of that, I tend to drop the W in whole, because that's what it looks a lot like. We congratulate ourselves, we go to a meeting with the Home Office, who are responsible for social change, for education, for a range of activities which are absolutely fundamental to your success. The truth is, most of those won't turn up, and they certainly don't like people in uniform. And yet we pat ourselves on the back because we have good relationships with the Bureau, 6, 5, whatever the case may be, and say that we have, in fact, joined our whole-of-government approach. Whole-of-nation, the private sector, we've heard some of that. Not embraced, not drawn in, not a genuine partnership. An occasional what I call passing engagement, meeting engagement, to use the old Cold War threat. And the last point, it's about a change in circumstance. The last bullet, crushed by synchronized asymmetric attack, the best form of words I can come up to it, this is the gray zone. This is not about one asymmetric threat which you now, in fact, address around and deal with. This is about a whole pile of illicit networks and activities drawn together by not design, but because people can see advantage in convergence and weakness in the nation states where opportunity lies. And this space, this gray space, the gray zone, is precisely where you need people who think differently, who act decisively, who can bring capabilities that don't exist in your armed forces elsewhere and make things happen. And yet it's really, really, really challenging. And Napoleon, he was crystal clear. Moral is to the physical 3-1. We get fixated on the kit, on the gear, on the technology, on the capability. The people are every bit as important. Weapons of mass destruction, they'll take your breath away. I went to Tokyo in 1994, had a look at the Onsen. You know, they had weapons quality sarin, that's a long time ago. They were dipping around in biologicals. This stuff's going to be around, it's going to come around, you've got to keep an eye on it. But weapons of mass disorder, by design, or by happen chance, by circumstance, by unintended consequence, keep ticking the list off. This is going to quite simply unravel the world. And in that space, opportunity then presents itself. And if I can see this shit, you can guarantee that General Soleimani and a whole range of others can see it as well. Henry Kissinger isn't wrong. Things are just unraveling. Climate, demographics, poverty, wealth, food, space, power, anger, retribution. People ask me about defense and security. I tell you, rat's ass about defense and security. What I'm really interested in is stability. Instability, she's the daddy. And your world? Well, here's the bad news. What was has a certain certainty. What is broadly uncertain, and it's what you face. What's coming? It's friggin' unknown. You had to deal with the Cold War. We all dealt with the Cold War with the first. all that stuff on the left-hand side, you know, the old rules of need to know, hard wire, red stars, multiple envelopes, limited access. 9/11 came along, we went into the mid-range, but we needed to share. That Prince note and a few others undid that in a heartbeat, and we now go into who to trust, who to blame. Actually, in many ways, we've gone backwards, and the problem is that you have to face, in your operating and future space, all those problems on the left, all the problems on the middle, and all the emergent problems on the right. You talk about a wicked problem, this is off the charts. Because you've now got to try and work out form and format, what to do, how to do it, in order to deal with this. But first of all, you have to do, I think Albert Einstein was once asked the question, look, 60 minutes to save the world, what are you going to do? He said, I spent 55 minutes defining the problem, 5 minutes finding a solution. My experience of life, people spend 59 minutes trying to find a solution, last minute blaming everyone else. You've got to define the problem. And so while it's unknown, it's really grey. If you don't, I have absolutely no confidence whatsoever. I'll be dead, so I don't give a shit. I have absolutely no confidence whatsoever that anyone else will grapple, grasp, and deal with that lot on the right. You can take NSA, GCH, MI5, MI6, FBI, CIA, you tick it off here, and you can look at violent extremism, knowns, suspected and connected. It's all the bloody rest. Half of them not even on the grid yet. They're going to come out and tear your heart out. They're not going to tear your heart out. They're going to tear the heart out of your way of life. They'll change the fundamentals of your nation state. And oh, this is what y'all will do.
Just literally
danced around you and laughed. Oh, they died in the process. And anyone inside Syria and Iraq is aid, disposable, expendable, force as far as the movement is concerned. The nature of the beast is just that, it's a beast. Love Albert Einstein. I think his great line was, in many ways, there are two things which are infinite. The universe and human stupidity. He paused and said, I'm not sure about the universe. Yeah. He also said that the two most attractive character qualities, and here was a guy that was off the charts when it came to forward thinking, self-confident, simply brilliant, was curiosity and that imagination. So why you keep on looking for scientific answers when you start looking for the hard wiring? Yeah? Just let your imagination, as an old bloke I find increasingly, you know, the advantage, you might say, you know, when I finish this, you say, what the hell are you talking about? You should add some real serious to here to finish off in many ways for this conference. I find that when presented with a wicked problem, the temptation is to walk towards it and try and solve it, wrestle with it, come up with an answer. Actually, as I get older, I find the trick is to walk backwards. Stop and then walk further backwards. You have to give yourself perspective. You have to give yourself perspective because things are never, ever what they seem. One of the British field marshals once said, things are never as good or as bad as you think they are. So when you're doing well, yeah, beware. And when you're doing really badly, beware. I wrestled with this one for a while. But hell. 10 years, 10%. Me and Stans and Russell, we came to the conclusion that we were probably being charitable at 20 years and 20%. I sense the two of us could be wrong. The figures are simply this. The people in here, your established culture, and your competencies. 20% will be relevant in 20 years' time. What fills the other 80%? Well, your imagination is going to take you there because you're dealing with real problems which are not going to be solved from merely doing harder than what you did in the past. And if I'm being really harsh, that'll be 10% in 10 years. So it's back to the future. Where did you come from? Where was the start point for all this stuff? 1942, David Sterling. Ask yourself today, who's acting unconventionally, unpredictably, or unexpected? Well, it's not you. All this stuff matters. But in 1942, when the special forces, in many, you know, as I would recognize the modern special forces, they've been around forever and a day, presented the unexpected capability. In 2016, it's adjusted to all of the above, this stuff below, but you're becoming fixed. Dangerously predictable. Understand?